Hello everyone, I'm Arda Yi from MyCube Lab. I'm a second year PhD student and I'm presenting you today my work during the first 2 years of my thesis on the design and the control of an aerial manipulator with elastic suspension. When I began my thesis, it was the end of the Dexterweight project. The Dexterweight project was on cable-driven parallel robots, and people in my team were especially interested in active stabilization techniques of these robots involving additional actuators on the moving platform. Here you can see the PCR3 robot. It's a planar CDPR which has four additional cold gas thrusters in order to do active damping of the robot. When I began my PhD, we were asking the following question. What is the simplest CDPR we can have? And our answer is a robot with one cable but with a moving anchoring point. Well, we can say that this robot is not parallel anymore. You can also say that this robot is closer to an aerial robot rather than to a CDPR. Indeed, a similar concept already exists in the field of aerial manipulation, but with propellers rather than cold gas thrusters. At the left, you can see the Spider Mav. It's a quadcopter that uses a cable to suspend in order to optimize its energy consumption and to deal with windy conditions. At the right, we have the CableSAM, the cable suspended aerial manipulator. It's an omnidirectional drone equipped with a robotic arm and it's suspended via a winch actuated cable to an aerial carrier. The system we propose is quite similar to this one. It's a Dexter robot. It consists of an autonomic aerial vehicle equipped with a gripper and is suspended by a low stiffness spring to a robotic carrier in order to move its equilibrium point. We propose this robot for tasks requiring a relatively large road space. Its workspace can be bigger than that of industrial robots, but obviously it's only smaller than that of standard UAVs. It has medium accuracy, at most 5 mm, and it can have really fast dynamics. It can be as fast as a racing drone. This robot can be used for tasks such as pick and place, automatic shipbuilding, 3D construction building, or cleaning or painting on building walls. Here you can see our first prototype that we built during my first year. Here we are not using a robotic carrier. The robotic carrier is used to move slowly at the equilibrium point of the robot to the average position of the current task. But if the task doesn't need a large workspace, we may not use a robotic carrier. The spring is for gravity compensation, but also it brings some mechanical simplicity since we save an additional actuator. The main structure is an omnidirectional aerial vehicle built using carbon fiber tubes, 3D printed parts, and some standard drone components. It has six propulsion units positioned with an intuitive layout in order to generate a 6 degrees of freedom wrench and to have a symmetrical mass distribution. If we want to be able to control the 6 degrees of freedom with six propulsion units, these propulsion units need to be bidirectional for propulsion units. The easiest way to do this would be using a bidirectional motor with symmetrical propellers. However, at the beginning of my thesis, we're ignoring if the propeller dynamics, so the drag due to the aerodynamic friction, the reaction torque due to the acceleration of the rotor, and the gyroscopic effect were important or not. That's why we decided to work with coaxial motors with contra-rotating propellers. In this way, we can cancel these propeller dynamics. And then, if we notice that these dynamics are not important, we can always use one motor to push in one direction and the other motor to push in the other direction, so we won't need bidirectional motors. For measurements, we are using a 6-camera Vicon-Bonita motion capture system and a 3 degrees of freedom gyroscopic sensor at the center of the frame. Also, we have an onboard computer, a Raspberry Pi, that runs the control algorithm. The force generated by a propulsion unit is proportional to the squared rotational velocity of the propellers. So if we want to do a force control on the robot, we need to have a speed control of the propellers. Each brushless DC motor is equipped with a driver called ESC for electronic speed controller. However, despite its name, ESC does not provide speed control. That's why we decided to develop a homemade firmware that we call TinCShot. TinCShot runs on a TinC microcontroller unit and it communicates with ESCs. It sends a control signal by a state-of-the-art digital protocol called DShot, and it receives back a telemetry signal containing, among others, the electrical RPM of the robot. Then it runs a PID loop at 500 Hz in order to control the speed of the propellers. Let's see now how efficient is our controller. Here we are using, in this video, we are using contra-rotating propellers. And if you look closely at the shadow at the center of the image, you can see that we have a wave interference figure. When this wave interference figure is static, it means that both propellers are rotating at the exact same speed. We suppose that the propulsion units are pure force generators. This assumption is true in find is especially true when we are working with contra-rotating propellers. Then we only have one-body dynamics that can be easily written using one set of Newton-Euler's equations. We have three external forces acting on the system. We have the gravity, the spring-restoring force, and the associated torque at the center of gravity of the robot, and the total range of the actuators. To parameterize the rotations, we are using standard roll PGO angles. So we have an analytical Jacobian matrix that maps the derivatives of these parameters to the angular velocity vector omega. As I said at the beginning, we're ignoring if the propeller dynamics were important or not. In order to have more information, we decided to do some tests to highlight these effects. So in this slide we are comparing the contra-rotating and the non-contra-rotating propellers for different propeller dynamic effects. We are starting with the drag and the reaction torque. In this first video, so we are using contra-rotating propellers and we are generating a force in the z direction, and that starts here. And we see that we have a small drag and a small reaction torque. Now let's see what happens with non-contra-rotating propellers. Here we are doing a really quite similar experiment. First, we see that when the motors are starting to rotating, we have some reaction torque that disturbs the system. But also, we notice that when we are generating the force along the z direction, the drag and the reaction torque are more important. So we can notice that the contra-rotating propellers have a slight advantage for these effects, but it's nothing that we cannot compensate using feedback control using closed loop control. Now let's look at the gyroscopic effect. We are starting with non-contra-rotating propellers. And here we are doing a very fast yaw movement, and we can see that the z-axis of the robot is tilted and is doing some sort of precession-like movement, like a gyroscope. So here it looks like the gyroscopic effect is really important. Now let's look what happens with the contra-rotating propellers. Again, with the z-axis of the robot is tilted and is doing again a precession-like movement. However, it's not possible to have a gyroscopic effect using contra-rotating propellers. It's almost perfectly cancelled. So what we are seeing in these two last videos, it's not the gyroscopic effect. It's another unmodeled behavior, much more important than the gyroscopic effect. We think that it can be turbulences. But in any case, for the gyroscopic effect, the contra-rotating propellers do not have any advantage. There are also some drawbacks working with contra-rotating propellers. We need bidirectional motors, and these motors need to change the rotation direction quite often. When you are changing the rotation direction, the motor needs much higher currents, and so we are heating motor and the driver. But also, at low speeds, the electronic speed controller is not capable of measuring the rotational velocity. So the robot is in open loop for a certain amount of time, and this adds some nonlinearities to the behavior of the motor. Here, I'm presenting you some preliminary results we had at the end of my first year. In this case, here we are assuming that the robot has a linear behavior around its equilibrium point, and then we are using a PID controller that runs at 100 Hz in order to stabilize the six degrees of freedom pose of the robot. At the time, we're ignoring the influence of the model dynamic propeller dynamics. That's why we're working with contra-rotating propellers. We see that in the free motion case, the robot is not damped at all, but in the pulse-regulated case, it's stabilized after a few seconds. Obviously, a simple PD controller is not enough to control the robot in 3D space, especially when we don't have a robotic carrier. That's why we are working on more sophisticated controllers. One of them is the compensator controller. The compensator controller is a particular case of feedback linearization technique, but for mechanical dynamic systems. Combining the Newton-Euler's equations and the analytical Jacobian, we can write the robot's dynamic model in the standard form for robotics. The computer controller aims to choose the right input torque in order to have the desired error dynamics, and the right input is given in the second equation on the slide. To do this, we need to estimate the MC and G matrices, which are denoted with hats here. We also need the desired acceleration term, and finally, we have a term, U, that can be tuned in order to impose the desired error dynamics. With the compensator controller, asymptotic stability is guaranteed when U behaves like a PD controller. Let's look at this diagram in order to see more intuitively how the computer controller works. So we are using the measurements from the system in order to invert the robot to invert robot dynamics. As I said, this inversion step is estimating the dynamic matrices of the dynamic model of the system. Then we are using a feed forward. We have a feed forward action on the desired acceleration term, and we have a feedback action using a PD controller on the error, which is the difference between the pose of the desired pose of the robot and the actual measured pose. Yeah, I'm presenting you now some experimental results we had with the computer controller. These experiments were done with a new prototype built during my second year, where the main difference between this one and the previous one is a pulley that we have added in order to have the spring horizontal, so we can avoid the effects of the transverse vibration of the spring due to its own mass. In this experiment, we are starting with a positioning, so we are putting this band in a hole with a 3 cm diameter. Then we are drawing 2 rectangles on a paper. I just want to insist on the fact that for this drawing task, we are just using the repeatability of the robot. We are not estimating the interaction force between the pen and the paper. We are just repeating an already learned trajectory. And now if we look at the result of the drawing, we see that we have 2 rectangles which are quite similar. We add the maximum error between these 2 rectangles. The maximum distance between these 2 rectangles is 1 cm. But now we are asking what happens when we want to do trajectories but faster. Obviously, we need higher acceleration, and then we are saturating the actuators. Here in this first video, the robot is doing a square trajectory on a tilted plane with a maximum speed of 1 m/s. In this case, we are not saturating the actuators, and we have a maximum position error of 1 cm and a maximum angular error of 0.1 radian. Now let's look at the same trajectory, but with a higher maximum speed. Here we are doing again a square trajectory, but at 1.5 m/s. And we see that the angle, we see that we have some angular overshoots at the corners, where we need higher accelerations. The angular error here is twice as much as before. We have 0.2 radians. This is quite normal because the computer controller is not taking into account the possible actuator saturations. So obviously the trajectory is deteriorated. In order to deal with the situation, we are working on another control law, the model predictive control strategy. The main idea of MPC is to simulate the future of a dynamic system for different inputs and to choose the best one, the optimal one for a given cost function. More precisely, it consists on solving an optimization problem under equality and inequality constraints. It has some advantages for us. First of all, it takes into account the actuator saturations, but also it takes into account motor dynamics. As I said, using TNC shot, we are doing a speed control loop on the motors. And this speed control loop has its own dynamics. It was tuned to have a first order transfer between the desired rotational velocity and the actual rotational velocity. This control loop dynamics were not taken into account in the computer control controller. But it can be taken into account easily with a model predictive control framework. Also, the model predictive controller is much more generic with respect to redundancies. With the computer controller, if we want to take into account, for example, the redundancies added by a robotic carrier, we would need to solve a control allocation problem. But it's quite native, it's already quite native in the model predictive control. We only need to adapt to the cost function of the controller. For nonlinear systems, there are different ways to implement a model predictive controller. One of them is quite similar to the computer controller and it consists on using feedback linearization. So have a linear system, then you can use linear MPC. The main drawback with this method is that we have some saturations that are constantly written in nonlinear model. But after the linearizing input, these saturations become dynamic. We can also use successive linearization techniques, so we can linearize the system at the actual operating point. Then, assuming that the system is only slightly nonlinear, we can use linear MPC. And also, we can use some gain scheduling strategies, so we can have different linear model predictive controllers for different areas in the state space. And finally, there is a solution to using nonlinear model predictive controller. So we are not doing any assumptions on the type of nonlinearities of the system. This method needs much more computational power, but also it's easier to implement using recent tools like Akados that generates optimized C code. These recent tools like Icarus also are using state-of-the-art QP solvers, optimal problem solvers, so we can have some similar results with nonlinear malapractive controller compared to linear predictive controller. In our case, the optimization problem is formulated as the following. We have a cost function that's a weighted sum of the squared and state errors and the energy of the input. With this formulation, if we want the cost function to converge to zero, then we need the energy of the input to tend to zero. With the commutator controller, the input we are using is the force generated by propellers, or equivalently the rotational speed of the propellers. However, if for example in steady state, this force is never zero except at the equilibrium point. That's why we decided in the model predictive controller case to use the derivative of the desired rotational velocity. So then the desired rotational velocity becomes an element of the state vector. Also in the state vector, we have the actual rotational velocity, and these two are linked by a first order transfer that we tuned with Tintishot. In the state vector, we also have the pose of the robot and the twist of the robot, and their dynamics are described using the analytical Jacobian and the Newton-Euler's equations. We are only using saturations on the desired rotational velocity. It's a software saturation, and in our case, the value is 22,000 RPM. And past this value, we do not have any more this first order transfer between the desired rotational velocity and the actual rotational velocity. For now, we are working on the last experiment using the computer controller mainly in order to have a quantitative description of the robot's repeatability and accuracy. Also, we want to do the experimental validation of the nonlinear malapractive controller on the robot. We already have some really promising simulation results. And finally, we would like to integrate the robotic carrier to the system so we can move the equilibrium point of the robot in space and to optimize its energy consumption. So we'll also need to deal with the redundancies. Finish. We have one accepted paper at the ICRA conference, at this year's ICRA conference, where I was the first author and the presenter of the paper. And the paper was on the stabilization robot that I presented at the beginning. Also, we have submitted one paper at the IRIS conference where I was the co-author, and the paper was on a cable-driven parallel robot, but was using propellers rather than coal gas thrusters. And finally, we would like to submit one international journal paper mainly on the results with the computer control. During these 2 years, I also had the opportunity to contribute to 3 Git repositories. One of them is Tintishot, where I'm the main developer with Jack. The second one is ARPIT, so it's a toolkit developed by Jack, and that is based on Simulincolor, and that makes it really easy to do hardware-in-the-loop experiments using a Raspberry Pi. Finally, I have some minor contributions to Icarus. Thank you for listening.